Welcome to Millerville Community Church.
Our youth group packed 152 shoeboxes for Operation Christmas Child. Thank you to Joan Tosh, Glenn Baxter, and parents. You still have 2 weeks to bring in more shoeboxes. Pickup is Sunday, November 15th. Shoeboxes packed from Canada will be going to Central America and the west coast of Africa. Women in Leadership Workshop will be held Wednesday, December 2nd, 12 p.m. at the Sheep River Library. This workshop, led by Jan Burney, will be an in-depth look at the three main biblical passages that are used to keep women out of leadership. Let's dig in deeper to know what they actually say. Please register with the Sheep River Library. We now have Bibles available in four other languages for your use: French, Chinese, Arabic, and Korean.
Thank you. my feet to try to see. So if this begins in process, it's a thing. We are asking you to make a day of our wisdom and spiritual understanding. So you will walk worthy of the Lord, fully teaching to the truth and the truth of the word, growing in knowledge of Jonathan with all power, according to his glory of God. And so, thank you.
Just imagine
someone's home right now, all wrapped up in a blanket with their slippers on. All exposed to war, and they've got hot chocolate in their hand. But it's good to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to be with all of you as well. To be worshiping the Lord and to know His grace and His mercy in our life. I just want to tell you a prayer. Almighty God, we are meeting you right now in your power and authority to come. To open our hearts and minds to receive the revelation that you want to give us, that we might understand the importance of things that are going on in the world, and yet the even more important things you are accomplishing that you intend to do right now by your power and authority. We pray today, right now, that you would speak and move in a mighty way in our lives, that you might know our will and the things to come. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. Part 3 of a 7 series called Prophetic Preparation. If you haven't heard it previously, I hope you'll go back and listen to it. You might also want to listen to a copy of Pastor John on YouTube. There's more detail about things that I'm getting into that I can cover on this Sunday morning with you. I can't cover it, but you don't want to be here for 3 hours, and there's a lot to be said. So today we're moving on to a new thing called economic control. And to begin with, I want to start with headlines and to make you aware of that. And then you're going to know a lot of the new features, name of the Wiuff. And he is the founder of the executive chairman of the World Economic Forum. And he recently said, "The world must act quickly and swiftly to revamp all aspects of our society and economy, from education to social contracts and working conditions. Every country, from the United States to China, must participate. And every industry, from oil and gas to tech, must be transformed. In short, we need a great reset of technology." At the World Economic Forum, an expert on a meeting in early June of 2020, Chris Charles, quoted as saying, "We have a golden opportunity to see something good from this pandemic crisis. This unprecedented shockwave may well make people more receptive to big business to change. And global crises like pandemics and climate change know no borders and highlight just how interdependent we are as one people sharing one planet. It is an opportunity we have never had before and may never have again. So we must use all the leaders that need leaders of power. We have at our disposal knowing that each and every one of us has a vital role to play." Now, further on to a headline from our own Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau. And after the pandemic will not be the same as it was before, Justin Trudeau has said, if he has his way, he's been reported. He's not talking about the bankrupt individuals or businesses forever shut down by COVID-19, but he's talking about the shape of the economy, quote unquote. "This is our moment to change the future for the better," Prime Minister Trudeau said, "but the announced parliament will come back in September. We can't afford to miss it because the window of opportunity will not be open for long. It was required to fundamentally transform Canada in the middle of the pandemic." Quote unquote, the taps are really going to be turned on as the global source for leaders this year. Today, we stand at a precipice of global change. There are those on the inside the globalist camp who tell us the plan to use the pandemic crisis to force universal vaccination, accompanied by a requirement of health passports, digital ID with the consequences of contact tracing of the population of the entire world. We are told by insiders that those who do not accept these measures will be confined to just follow parallel of the apple and hope the weather to your right person. That's what I'm doing. At that time, it makes sense. We just have an election in the United States. President, Vice President Joe Biden is the president-elect according to all the media, and is promoted globally as well. Those are the headlines. What do they mean? What is this all about? What is about to take place in our world that everyone is saying in the headlines, whether you're for it or against it, will be epic and global all around the world? For the last 40 years, political progressives have tried to use global warming, climate change, their coverages of fear to justify all kinds of changes and the advances of their objectives. Their latest example of the revolutionary change is called the Great Reset, as a result of the coronavirus pandemic, which is the most radical plan yet devised. The Great Reset you're going to hear about a lot in the future, and I want you to be aware of it. There's a website, just Google it, you're going to find it. It's called the Great Reset website. Everything I'm sharing with you today, you can find online to the site. It advocates calling for the proposed global change, the goal to change capitalism into another system called stakeholder capitalism. So right now, they say we have shareholder capitalism. That means you buy a share into a company, and the company earns a profit, and you get a return on your share. Now they're proposing that all your shares will move from shareholder to stakeholder. Stakeholder is that everyone has a stake in the company, and that companies will be required to advance social, economic agendas. And that will be about worker conditions, but also to see civil rights, like racism and many other things. And these social agenda issues will be required part of every company, even over profit. And that will fundamentally change capitalism. This agenda is to get companies to be governed by their social responsibilities, they'll put it, as dictated by global leaders rather than just the shareholders who can use the profit. Companies that support this idea are going to be powerhouses like Twitter, Facebook, Google, but there will also be manufacturers, refrigerators, and stores, and everything else you might buy or might charge. They're willing to use their considerable resources to advance the global agenda. And then, in an every country in the world. The Great Reset website, if you go to it, also says that they want to go beyond just a temporary virus shutdown. They want to completely eliminate the entire industry, starting with oil, gas, and coal, which produce carbon emissions, to the auto industry, which builds vehicles around on gasoline, to grounding airplanes to consume massive quantities of jet fuel. Their extreme positions are similar to the proposals of Flynn Collette when they talked about the New Green Deal and the many things, but now it's under the title of the Great Reset. The radical reactions to the virus pandemic are being used by world leaders to create revolutionary changes that many people are truthfully expected to make change for the state. The author of the Big Reset, William Middlekooper, believes that something is bound to happen soon since the International Monetary Fund publishes the speeches. And in 2014, he wrote the Big Reset, tweeted to his 42,000 followers this. The most important trial, chapter 6, the Big Reset, new rules have been discussed. Not only inside the advanced economies, but with all emerging economies, including China, with the status of the U.S. dollar as the international reserve currency being taken, a new global currency is being set up and conceived. This is all coming at us faster than we ever thought it would. And it is a sensitive issue. And nothing really can be spent now in public. The officials of the Great Website and many others have said that we really don't want to let everybody know that we are planning to not use the U.S. dollar anymore as we're currency. We're going to create a global currency. And if we announce that today from the IMF, the American dollar would cost enough for something because it depends on being the global currency. So they're already making transitions because they are behind the doors to set up for this transition from the American dollar to the global currency back to gold. So as these changes are being made and are happening behind the door, we're steadily marching towards what we call a new one world order with open borders, open economy, and one world currency. Nations will no longer matter, and all barriers and even religions will be amalgamated into a globalist plan. And the Bible tells us that such a day would come. And we have seen similar times throughout history, just like this in history, but nothing on the size and the scale of what we're looking at today. And we're going to prepare prophetically for what is to come and what must come next with the global economic control. We need to consider what the scriptures teach us and encourage us to consider and to take into account. So that's why we need to go to the Word of God. So turn with me to the book of Revelation. And we're going to go to chapter 13, if you will, with me. I'm going to be starting at verse 11, and I'm going down to verse 18, chapter 13 of Revelation. Then I saw a second beast coming out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon. It exercised all authority of the first beast on its behalf, and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound was healed. It performed great signs and even causing fires coming down from heaven to the earth in full view of the people. Because of the signs it was given power to perform on behalf of the first beast, it deceived the inhabitants of the earth in order that they set up a prince in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. The second beast was given power so that the image could speak and cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. It also forced all people, great, small, rich, and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hands or on their foreheads, so that they may not buy or sell unless they have a mark, which is the name of the beast, or the number of its name. And this calls for wisdom, that the person who has insight calculates the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, the number is 666. I'll tell you, in all my years of ministry in London, this is probably the first time I've preached on this topic. I've avoided it like the plague. I was a teenager in the 70s. Any of you remember the 70s? Are you that old? Do you remember all these apocalyptic messages in the 70s? The late great Canada was. Oh, I would read all the ready movies. That's terrible. I've heard all those things. And every time I open a passage like this, I hear all those old sermons and apocalyptic imagery from the past that comes rolling into my head, so I kind of just avoid it and go to more critical passages. But we are in a time when this is relevant information. I have taught apocalyptic literature in college, so I've got a master's degree, and I have delved into all this stuff quite heavily. But I'm not going to go where most ministers go with this type of stuff. So, but the problem with your preaching is, first I know that what you hold in your head, you think I'm going to say. And even if I don't say it, you will superimpose it on what I said. So stay with me. I might take a right or a left from where you're going or where you think I'm going to go. I might not go there. Then again, I might. Who knows? so just be alert. Don't sort of get lazy on it. Listen to what we're about to explore here. To read this passage, calls all of us to have apocalyptic vision of what the end of times might be. And that we would ask ourselves to suspend what we have heard before and just consider what the Word is saying. The main focus and word that you'll see in this passage is peace, right? The first beast, the second beast, the beast, and the beast of this, the beast of this. So the main character within this passage is peace. What is the beast? Who is the beast? And as in this passage, it says there are actually two beasts. And it answers the main section in Revelation that it came from the sea and down from the earth, the second beast. If you read six books about this passage, it will give you six different interpretations of who and what the beast is. I know, I've read them. And they don't agree. There's a lot of disagreement. Well, who are they? Who is this? What is it about? And the confusion lies around it being a future event where we invoke the speculations of our personal biases of what it is. So we look at our current context here. If you were in America, the outbreak of World War II, you would say the beast was Hitler, and he certainly was bestial, and he was close, world dominance, and all that kind of stuff. If you were in England during the French Revolution and heard of the rise of Napoleon conquering all the nations of Europe, you would have said Napoleon was the beast. If you were a third or fourth century Christian early on, and you heard about Nero, you would have said Nero was the beast. And we've always said that we've always had our empires and our individuals that we have called beast-like description. Even back in Daniel, Old Testament, chapter 7, verse 23, Daniel references his insight to the beast and gives us an interpretation from Scripture how we understand what the beast is. It says in verse 23 of Daniel 7, thus he said, this is medieval, the fourth beast will be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which will be different from all other kingdoms and will devour the whole earth and spread it down and crush it. The point here is not which or who the beast is, but who is equal to empire. And there have been many bestial empires throughout the history of the world. Can we agree on that? All right. And empires are like beasts because they're unnatural. The way you hold an empire together is by overt control. You use money. You need economy. You need political force. But unless you have those elements, you can't hold the empire together. It will fall apart. And you know why? Because people are different. We speak different languages. We speak different cultures. We're different people. And we have different opinions. And we don't always want to cooperate with each other. Is that news to you? So at any time someone thinks, oh no, we can have a British Empire. It doesn't matter if they're in India or if they're in Hong Kong. They're all love to be in the British Empire, especially those Americans. And if you don't exercise some sort of control over it, you can't keep that empire together. So it's an external control. And that's why it's peace-like. It's an unnatural working together of the outward conformity and unity of a group of people, whether they want to be together or not. This has been true of Babylonian empires, Persian empires, and they're described in Daniel as peace-like, but all empires are those ways. Right now, the globalists are working, and have been working for a very long time, but are proposing to use the pandemic for any other thing they can do, to couple together in the single greatest empire the world has ever seen. A global empire. Where we're all forced, unnaturally, to be in agreement disagreement and dissension will be removed, or at least suppressed. So to say then what most scholars would accept, that in this passage of Revelation 13, the beast is an empire without naming what the empire is. It is the coming empire, which the scriptures say, where nations and kingdoms will be forced to merge into a great elemental beast held together with great power. That's the way it describes this. And another way to describe this beast is a more modern word, a monster. It's monster. I would further suggest that empires can be identified by the dominant currency in the world. There have been many great resets, did you know this, in world history. We've already lived freedom. And each great reset in world history has resulted in the change of the dominant currency. You can go back to the Rome with the Daenerys. You can go to the Byzantine time, where that was the dominant coin. 15th century, it was Florence that dominated the world. And then in the 17th century, it was the Netherlands. They were actually the great kings of the world. And then we went to the Spanish dollar when they found all that Aztec gold in the 18th century. And then we went to the British pound as the world currency in the 1920th century. After World War II, it was the U.S. And each one marks a change of empire. I want to suggest to you, according to this, that the mark of an empire is not really identified so much by others, but by currency. It is the money we use. And that's where the real control over our lives comes. This passage. This sermon today is about prophetic preparation for economic control. And economic control is in the use of the currency you have. The power of empire is very beastly. This is all true. If anything I have laid down before you is accurate so far, I believe, and I believe it is, then the new unnatural beast or monster that is rising as a global power is the most unnatural and holy way. It will attempt to merge all nations of the world and cultures and religions into one great big mess, like global unity. It believes that the great beast is being established in some secret Frankenstein lab someplace. They're assembling it back. They're piecing it together the best they can. And one day they're going to just fire it up. You ever see those old Frankenstein movies? A lightning bolt comes down and brings them alive. And you roar. Well, that birthday is coming, and it's called the Great Reset. And it's just around the corner when the beast life of the world emerge. The establishment of the worldwide empire, or the new one world order, is so difficult and so unnatural that it requires a great deal of coercion to keep various people together and its parts down. Primary tool of doing this has always been the economy. We have seen earlier models of this. The goal deals were made several times to bring this beast to life over the years, but one of these days they're actually going to succeed and they're going to launch the Great Reset. And now, it really doesn't seem to be a lot of things holding them back. Empires of this world are always monstrous, fantasy. Kind of creation that unnaturally forced people together in languages and worldviews and cultures to fit in the global system and one world belief system. A great deal of control is always needed in military and money and in unnatural compliance to this monstrous perspective. This has always been true and it's always a privilege way. Rome operated this way, Greece operated this way, every empire operates this way. The beast empire that is coming will produce a leader, and that leader will be against Christ. It will be an anti-Christ. The anti-leaders come out of the beast that produces it. This will become a coming, as it has always come and as it has come before. You will see the last system of control is to move our devotion from worship of God and to other things to this leader, this figure that we will be asked to worship. Very Christians knew this when they were asked to worship the emperor's realm of the doubt, and they refused to do so. Now, why is this the nature of peace? Why are we encouraged to always move and the final issue of control is worship, believing or not? Here we are, worshiping together in beautiful church and worshiping our Lord our God, and we feel better. But whenever world empire comes and getting us into conformity, this is the single greatest threat, our gathering together to worship towards empire. If we are not advocating what the beast is and worshiping in it, then we are not coming voluntarily under the control of that beast. Christians, for that matter, have always have been for 2,000 years a threat to empire. And it makes no difference where you go in the world. They are always a threat to empire because they won't worship anyone but the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's consider this passage. 1 John chapter 2, 18 to 19. Dear children, this is the last time, and you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, and even now, many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last time. They went out from us, but they do not really belong to us. For if they belonged to us, they would have remained with us, but they're gone, we said that none of them. But back there in the book of John, 1 John, that letter, he said there was already opposition to Christ. There has always been opposition to Christ. But this opposition increases to epic levels as new empires arise and the new ones come. Why is there such anger towards Jesus Christ? Behind the beast is the dragon, according to Revelation. And the dragon is Satan himself. His goal is to gain control over the whole earth. And he is angry at Christ and at the church that Christ has established on this earth. Revelation chapter 6, 5 through 6, we see this. When the Lamb opened the third seal, I heard third living creature say, "Come." And look, and there before me was a black horse, this rider was holding a pair of scales in his hand. Then I heard what sound like a voice among the four living creatures saying, 2 pounds of wheat for a day's wages, and 6 pounds of barley for a day's wages, and do not damage the oil and the wine. In this verse, John writes what he has heard and what was seen by the voice coming in the midst of the four living creatures. The voice announces a quarter of wheat was sown for Damascus, and 3 quarters of barley cost for Damascus. Symbolically, this essentially means to indicate the experience of a real world crisis where war and famine gives way to inflation and due to supply and demand. In the great reset that is coming, as it follows in the past, it will usher in the new East Empire of this past in the past. And the difference is that the one that is coming is unlike any other one that has come before, and it's going to change the economics of the way things are working. I would suggest that what that Revelation passage suggests to us is that essential goods will become hard to come by, that there will be hunger. Basically what it says. We can conjecture that war is going on. But one of the stated objectives of the globalists in the new Great Reset is to limit travel. They don't want you flying in planes. They don't want you driving your car. They want to lower your consumption of goods. There isn't enough food to go around. But their goal grow to increase must be like. So maybe you can't get good food, but you can own a cell phone. We watch it connected all the time, everywhere. Everybody has a nice device in your home where you can always be monitored. But the stuff you essentially need, it will become real. And this great reset is not necessarily just wars and famines that bring on. It can be orchestrated in that way that we're in control of the people. So now I have 30 defenses. So how do we prepare prophetically and economically for this great new world order and the change of the time of the world? What did we say? The reason they're coming after the church and after Christians around the world, and right now Christianity is the single most persecuted, identifiable religious group in the world right now. And we are because we're in the way of the globalists. Why? Because we don't worship them. We worship them. And why is that the problem? Trust my friends. There is a problem that empire builders who go together with Frankenstein beasts always run into. They discover that there isn't an ambassador out there. There is already an empire in place. And it has been there for 2,000 years. The empire was established with the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, where he defeated the devil. And he put down the old devil. And he gave the keys of this empire, of the kingdom, to who? To the believers. To give us power and authority over every demonic king, over principalities and powers in the air. We have the power. He stood before Pilate and said, "You have no power. You can do nothing except that I allow you to." And Christians have been saying that for 2,000 years. There is an answer. It is the kingdom. Kingdom means where God rules. Where does he rule? Here, right now. But it's not like the beast empires that the world always wants to put together. Because the kingdom of God is purely by your decision, by repentance of sin, to receive Jesus Christ as your king. And when you do that, you become a type of empire of God. You're not forced. You don't have to do it. And you don't have to suddenly try to make your thoughts and your culture fit the kingdom of God. What he does is make you an unlawful person naturally apply the kingdom of God by placing your Holy Spirit on you, your authority on you, and you start speaking in a language you never spoke before, you start thinking in a way you never thought before. You start seeing things you never understood before. You're being translated, as Scripture says, from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. You're entering a whole new empire of will. And then you're supposed to say the most basic prayer any Christian has ever taught to pray: "My kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." We are the empire of God when we come into the kingdom of God. And every empire that has ever been cobbled together in some Frankenstein lab of humanity has always had to face the real empire of the reign of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it doesn't matter if it was Russia in the communist reign or Constantine. It doesn't matter if it was Pol Pot. It doesn't matter where it takes place. Empires have always tried to stand power to stage. And they have always failed. It can't do. We are greater and more powerful than our Lord Jesus Christ. But an empire is coming right, the world is never seen. And it's not the issues. You don't have to be trying to figure this out. This day might come. Their idea was the reason we're not accomplishing it. It's had to be us. It is called Christ. It's had to be all kinds of places. It was before the year 2000, Time Magazine declared God dead in America. He's not dead anyway. They keep trying to dethrone God all the time. This is always going on. So now that we've entered brilliancy, they figured out, I know what the problem is. I know why we can't overcome the church. We're just not big enough. We just need to make our monster bigger and more powerful, and we can do it. But it's going to be a global effort. Everyone, all the powers and leaders, everything has got to. We've got to throw everything we can at God's people. And here's the tell you, it's not enough. They want to succeed. What do you do to prepare as a member of the empire of our Lord Jesus Christ? How do you prepare for economic control? So, this affects your 401k, your stock investments, your house, and everything. I would suggest a very common sense for some, and I'm starting into investing, and I'm starting to see if I'm starting to talk about investments and tax advisors and all those kinds of things. But, let me go to the Lord Jesus Christ on this. I would suggest to invest in the kingdom of God, in the empire that will just be standing when the dust settles. We'll need to rely on God in the next while, and the new beast monster arrives. And God's people have always relied on the Lord Jesus Christ as the emperors have come and they have done. Moses led God's people against the empire of Egypt. Do you remember that story? And he defeated that empire. And when they were led into a desert place, where they were fed, they were watered, and they were protected against all odds. Not only that, they grew from slaves to a mighty army. That's what God does. God is not changed. We are God people today. We are still part of the global empire of God. It's not a monstrous thing because the kingdom of God is not held together by armies and by finances. It's not by forced worship of a false God. This is the kingdom of peace, the kingdom of love. When we freely give our hearts to our Lord Jesus Christ and we ask truly for him, do you remember the other part of the Lord's Prayer? This is, I hope it gives you a whole new meaning to the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You remember the next part, it's just deals with your economy. Give us this day our. How do slaves go from Egypt to an army in Canaan? Daily. The Lord has you. He has it all for you. The world may try to control all your currency, control your life in so many external ways, but I don't look to them for my daily bread. I pray a different prayer. I look to the Lord. Sam and I have recently been on a journey like this, but when we're starting out ministry, there's a very common prayer where the Lord shared how we're going to make bills got paid, or how you repair your vehicle, or many other things. But we live by that today there will be fresh matter. The lesson that the people of Israel learned was not to hoard. Because whatever you hoard will rot. But rely on God's provider instead. The best way to handle riches is not to have them. So, when I started ministry, I was a minister amongst the wealthy. And as I ministered with them, I don't still minister to hurt. But when I dealt with the wealthy, I realized their challenges were very different. And the one thing that the wealthy ran into all the time, the biggest concern they had was fear. Everyone was after my money. I don't know what to do. And I want to go to work. These people are trying to steal from me all the time. I never had that problem. But it was that. And I said, well, what's touching you? all this money, and you're so afraid of losing it all. And I don't have that fear, because it's more than a country with that much money. And I sympathize with him, I understood. And as life goes on, I accumulated some resources, and I realized what it's like to be stolen from. Any of you been stolen from? Anyone taking your house? Serious stuff? In my last engagement, I was pretty much been broken into four times. Stealing a soundboard and then got me really paranoid, putting alarms and everything else. It's still fun to steal from you all the time. We lost. Well, I get paranoid because I look at the equipment out there, that stuff would be gone too. They would come in and say, not near that. That's kind of a very pretty place you're living in. It's just a pile of when some serious is gone. It's good day, you know, but yeah, it happens all the time. And then I learned from the Lord that Terry found this for if you're rich, if you've got resources, and you're worried, if you're fearful, I can lay it all to rest. So this is what I realized what I needed to do. I needed to sign it all over to God. Every time. So that when people would say to me, "Hi, you have a nice house," I would say, "Oh, it's not my house. It's not his house, so his house is it. It belongs to God. It's his house. It's not my house. I'm just what God has to do. That's not my house, it's God's house." Then, when people try to steal, they say, "It's not mine that they're taking from. Who are they taking from? And is God able to protect what is his?" I pity the person that tries to rob God's house or God's resources. And it just took a load off of God's soul. I didn't have to worry about security guys or any of that. They said, "God is more than handle all these things." Matthew 6, verse 33, teaches us the very basic principle of his kingdom. "But seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." And there he is talking about the fear and anxiety of people. "Well, what about my, what I'm going to wear today, what I'm going to eat, what are we going to do tomorrow?" And the advice of Jesus Christ is to invest in the kingdom of God. Put that first. God will finance you all the rest of the way. Invest in the kingdom. Jesus told us that this is your only pure investment you can make for the great reset. Do not invest in coming beast your empire, but in the eternal kingdom of God that the beast is coming for. Jesus said to them, "Truly, I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits in his glorious throne, you will have followed me, will also sit on the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." That's the part left in Christ's death. And then verse 29, "Everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or fields, for my sake, will receive 100 times as much, and will inherit eternal life. But many of those who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first." Then he's saying, if you invest in the kingdom, you will see a huge return. It will come in this life and in the next life. He gave this advice to apply these passages to a rich young man who had a lot of resources. He went away sad, but he didn't want to invest. He wanted to hang on to his resources and to trust him. Invest first with your heart. Give it to the Lord Jesus Christ. It's more important than anything else that you have. And this is what Jesus preached in Matthew 4:17. And from that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of God and of heaven has come near." And it has. Says, "He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords." And he says, "Repent and step in the kingdom of God." And that's with your faith, with your daily prayer. And that's where you pray that in Matthew 6, 9-13. This is then how you should pray. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as earth and heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive our debt. That's going to be a huge one in the days to come. As we have forgiven our debtors. And give us not temptation, but deliver us from evil. I truly believe that is a 10-times prayer. You should also invest in church and in hope. Believe this passage where Paul says in Romans 8:31-39. Boy, if you haven't underlined this passage, you should make it a part of your great great Bible. Alright? In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. God can take that either death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the word of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God loves you and will provide for you. Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. His kingdom is here, it's now, it's in our midst, and he will reign over all creation. He has given us the keys of the kingdom, and we are winning, and will continue to win with great God when the peace is coming. There's only really one way all this conflict will ever end. The Psalm of Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. Therefore, God exalted him, that is, Jesus Christ, to the highest place, and gave him the name that is above every name. And at that name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That's the only way this can all be. There are great and terrible days ahead. There will be rumblings and worries, and people are going to be nervous and afraid all around. When the beast arrives and the great reset, and the currencies are changed, you are offered deals on your dollar to exchange it for a new world currency. I want you to remember this. It makes no difference whether it's a Roman coin or a British pound or a American coin. We are still in the kingdom of God. And it's all His. And He wins. And we have nothing to do. What must come. For God must once and for all get rid of monster making people and their effort to raise Frankenstein's again and again, and fully establish his empire. We are close to that day. When they wrote the New Testament, they thought they were in the last hours. We've got to be in the last hours. But they were in the last hours. I don't know how you figure that. But the time is near. There are believers who long to be in a day like this, and you get to be there. To be sounds too close to be good. What I would suggest is sign up. Swear your allegiance to the empire now. Take Jesus as your king. I feel clear that you have no king but King Jesus. And the prime ministers may come and go, and presidents, global leaders, but they all will go the way of man and die. But the empire of God, ever since Jesus established God as resurrection, has never passed away. I would recommend that if you want to be a part of an everlasting empire, that you swear allegiance to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is taking our new members right here. And all you have to do is forswear all past allegiance. Raise your hand and take the oath. Are you here today? If you want to declare, I'm part of the empire of God. I want to be a part of God. If you want to do that, I encourage you, whether you're online or you're here today, to raise your hand and bow your head with me. and take care to ignore us in their commitment to the empire of death. While we raise our hand and with clear conscience without coercion or persuasion by anyone else, we freely today declare that we have not been worthy of this kingdom that you are offering us. We have not earned citizenship in the empire of death. In fact, Lord, we don't even know why you're willing to receive us today, receiving in your kingdom other than your amazing love. And today we confess that we are far from ready. But if you would receive us today, Lord, and we believe you will, because of the work that Jesus Christ did upon the cross, where he defeated sin and once and for all, when he put the dragon under his heel, when he established God's church and ruling reign over this earth, that he's standing there before us right now with the keys of this kingdom ready to place them in our hands. Available. We come on ready before you. We take the need before you. We ask you that you don't change. Rule over us. And all that I have, and everything that I am, and all that I might ever have, Lord, I right now surrender it all into your hands. It is all yours. Lord, you are my king. You have not the authority to issue commands over me, to ask of me whatever you want, and I will do it. But it's not my life anymore. I freely surrender it into your hands. It's my sovereign, Lord, and Savior. I receive you now in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I hope you've taken that place in your life each and every day. A day will come where that place is going to cost you more than you know. That it will always protect you and keep you. For God protects what is good. God bless you. Thank you.